We're going to take a look behind the curtain at the world of the U.S. intelligence community, that alphabet soup of federal agencies that Trump frequently disdains or ignores. Trump has repeatedly dissed the intelligence services he commands. When they disagree with his views, he likes to say he's smarter than they are, suggesting that they need to go back to school. One of the daily rituals of the White House has traditionally been the president's morning intelligence briefing, considered an essential preparation for meeting the challenges of the highest office in the land. Yet, earlier this year, NBC News reported that President Trump had received an intelligence briefing in just 17 of the past 85 days. This begs the question, does the president really understand the intelligence structures he commands? If not, that's worrisome. But he wouldn't be alone. So what is the intelligence community? Who are they? Who do they work for? When you see a movie about spies or espionage, sooner or later you run into the big dog on the block, the CIA, the Central Intelligence Agency. Formed after World War II, the CIA was for decades the sole U.S. intelligence agency that operated overseas. Their work was done in the shadows of Europe and Africa and even Latin America as they sought to uncover and steal the Soviet Union's next moves by clandestinely recruiting their diplomats, their soldiers, and their scientists. The CIA repeatedly tried to kill Fidel Castro. It overthrew socialist governments in Guatemala and Chile. It stopped plots against American officials and our friends. Today, there are three main, but by no means exclusive, agencies that do intelligence abroad: the CIA, the FBI, and the DEA. Considered to be enormously powerful during the 1980s Central American wars, CIA agents were called Los Garcia by Salvadoran and Guatemalan rebels who swore that the CIA station chief was more important than the U.S. ambassador. The agency, as it is sometimes known, was hated and admired at the same time. I got to know many of them over my career. Mostly, they were anonymous, cultivating a fierce loyalty to their agency and a culture of silence. But when the Berlin Wall fell in 1989, so too did the primacy of the CIA in the American spy game, as threats to American interests have changed from state-sponsored communism to international organized crime and terrorism, drugs, arms, and human trafficking, most recently hacking and cyber warfare. The CIA has had to share its space in the shadows. The collapse of the World Trade Center on 9/11 marked a radical shift towards even greater specialization. The FBI, or Federal Bureau of Investigations, long the dominant presence of U.S. domestic law enforcement, began to expand its presence overseas in the 1970s. But that presence was put on steroids starting about 20 years ago. They focus on kidnappings, terror plots against the United States and the U.S. homeland, and fugitives from American justice around the world. They also keep a network of paid informants across the globe. The Drug Enforcement Agency, or DEA, created by Richard Nixon in 1973, runs its confidential human sources and intelligence activities to take down drug traffickers and get them prosecuted in U.S. courts via extradition, or, on occasion, by less judicial means of getting a foreign bad guy to face American justice. Add to them the DIA, the NRO, the NGIA, State Department's INR, DHS, Marine Intelligence, Navy Intelligence. The list goes on. Then there is the NSA. The Edward Snowden episode brought into the sunlight the highly secretive technical espionage enterprise known as the National Security Agency, or NSA. Because all these agencies work in the executive branch, their ultimate boss is the President of the United States. Inside the White House, the Office of the Director of National Intelligence, or DNI, allegedly sits on top of the intelligence network, coordinating it for the president. However, the DNI does produce one of the most highly secretive documents in the U.S. government, known simply as the PDB, the President's Daily Brief. Started during the Kennedy administration, it is usually the first thing presidents read or have orally briefed to them most days. Every president has a different style. And the IC, or intelligence community, tailors the daily briefing to each commander in chief. Some want tactical information, like Bush 43, about the invasion of Iraq and Afghanistan, or Lyndon Johnson, who wanted detailed intelligence about the war in Vietnam. Reagan mostly wanted raw and finished intelligence about the Soviet Union and its intentions. President Obama, a voracious and disciplined reader, wanted open source information included, newspaper, radio reports, not just raw intelligence and stolen secrets, so as to give him a more strategic versus a tactical understanding of the threats facing America. But President Trump, not so much. He reportedly doesn't read very much, and he's quickly bored with oral briefings by staff. Whatever his personal style, the president ignores his professional intelligence services and their information to his own and to our peril.